Should we do this?
Here we go.
Let's do it.
Da-da.
Ah, there we go.
There's that smile.
Hey, everyone, it's Hasan Minhaj. A few weeks ago, we put out a video about the murder of George Floyd at the hands of the police. In that video, we called for some very specific changes that we wanted everyone to get on board with. Ending qualified immunity, being involved in your local elections. But there was one specific reform that was directed at one specific person. This is for Keith Ellison. Keith, I know you are watching. You are the Attorney General in Minnesota, and you have this case now. You need to charge and prosecute all four officers as hard as you possibly can. Well, it turns out I was right. The Attorney General of Minnesota, who has this case right now, did see the video. So I'm here, joined by Attorney General Keith Ellison. What's up, Keith?
How you doing, man? Good to see you. Welcome to the Attorney General's office.
It's kind of crazy how this all went down.
So my wife and I are watching late night. You know, we love your show. And, you know, we're looking toward the end of the show, and you got your recommendations. And the last one, I mean, you're like, and Keith Ellison, and she.
That must be weird. Someone else, some Indian dude is screaming on TV about Keith Ellison. That must be a very surreal moment.
My wife goes, and she goes, do you know him? She said, you should call him. So then I started figuring out how I might be able to get a hold of you.
Yeah, I got multiple people that were hitting me up, man. You're pushy.
I know. So
I had three different people. Someone I went to college with, like in undergrad. I'm like, how is he? Brother Ali? There's all sorts of.
So like
you
the
went
Muslim
through
community
every single
is like
level.
This big, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Everybody is like, what, one degree of separation?
It's all good. I mean, I got a lot of shit from that video, specifically from the Muslim community. They loved every single point that I made, but they said, why did you have to go after making dua? Come on, man, how many Muslim fundraisers have you and I gone to where we pray for the community? We gotta make dua. We cannot just make dua. You know how the community gets sometimes. If you push back on some of those Sunday school rules, they'll push back on you. So for everybody watching, I just want you guys to know, I'm gonna kick this thing off with the dua, with the prayer, if it's cool with you, and I'll lead it.
Fine, either one of us.
Yeah, no, I'll lead it. And okay. Then the white people, you guys can pray too. So, you know, Brandon, Cody, Cole, just. You guys just participate. You ready? Here we go. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Let's do a short one. Rabbana atina fid dunya hasanatan wa fil akhirati hasanatan wa qina azaban nar. Oh Allah, please unite us all in the cause for justice. Oh Allah, please protect brother Keith Ellison. He is fighting the good fight, and this is a fight for justice. Ya Allah, please protect us from plaque, gum disease, and gingivitis. Oh Allah, you know how when you're on FaceTime audio and then it drops and it switches you to LTE, but then LTE also sucks. Yo Allah, please, please make LTE strong and better. You know how when you bite into an olive and there's still a pit in it, Allah. Allah, please protect us from the pit. Yo Allah, please, please bring back limited edition wasabi Doritos. They were really good, Allah, please. Yo Allah, please, please protect us from white women in yoga pants. Astaghfirullah, please. Ya Allah, please, please help brother Keith Ellison prosecute these four police officers to the fullest extent possible. Ameen.
Salaka Allahu Azim. Khatib. You know?
Were there any specific other shout outs that you wanted me to ask the man upstairs about? I think we got all of them.
Yeah, I think you covered the basics.
Scene one, take one, Amar.
Okay, Keith, let's just cut to the chase. Are these motherfuckers going to prison for 40 plus years or not?
I don't know, and I can't say.
Oh, come on, man. I flew out, I put a mask on, I had a fucking shield on a Delta Airlines flight, and you can't tell me anything?
I can tell you that we believe that the charges we filed can be proven beyond a reasonable doubt, and we're gonna get in front of a jury and we're gonna argue with everything we have.
You're gonna be in that room like an Aaron Sorkin movie, prosecuting.
I will be in the room, but I'm probably not gonna be the one actually trying the case. We have career prosecutors and others who are gonna be doing that.
Got it. After you took the case, charges were upped on Chauvin from third degree murder to second degree murder.
Minnesota's attorney general is increasing the charges against former Minneapolis police officer Derek Chauvin to second-degree murder in the death of George Floyd. Chauvin is facing up to 40 years in jail. Prosecutors are also charging the three other officers who were at the scene of Floyd's death with aiding and abetting murder.
Why? What happened? What evidence were you given that made you go, nah, this is second degree?
Well, I can't discuss the exact evidence.
Oh, come on!
Well, what I can tell you is that we reviewed it and we filed the highest ethical charges we believe we could.
You can't say, but you found something pretty good that made you up the...
Can't say.
Oh, come on. It was, you found... Just blink if you found some really good dirt on Chauvin.
I can't blink. I can't tell you. It's the way it is.
You blinked like four times just there right now, Keith. You blinked four times.
I didn't mean to. I was trying to not blink.
Okay.
But anyway, those blinks, they don't mean nothing.
This case has so much national attention. And the discourse has been, hey, all of the protesting, the rioting, the burning that has engulfed America, that has all led to this moment. What happens to America when we all wake up and we look at our phones and it says, Officer Chauvin is found not guilty? What would that America look like?
You know, I haven't thought about that because I don't think that's gonna happen. You know,
I'm afraid, I've thought about it.
Right.
Well, and you know what I've felt, Keith, is that if that happens, if you were mad that Target got burned, you don't wanna see the country if that's the outcome.
Well, let me tell you what I'm more afraid of.
Sure.
I'm more afraid that, you know, the lawyers for the defendants in this case will say, this is not about evidence. This is not about justice. This is about the system being afraid of a bad outcome. And therefore, this is not really a just prosecution. It's just people motivated by fear who are gonna convict our clients because of fear of the reaction of the community. And I say, I reject that 100%. I have not overcharged or undercharged this case. We have charged those counts, which we believe we can prove ethically, that second degree murder, and others as well down the complaint. And that I don't want the jury to convict because they fear a public outcry. I want the jury to convict because these people are guilty of what they're accused of.
It's interesting to me. In America, there's a lot of conversation about the efficacy of protesting. And it's become this very strange culture war, where and when you protest. But to me, I see a very direct timeline here. May 25th, George Floyd is murdered. Video goes viral, right? Protests. Protests erupt across the country. Rioting, burning. Motherfuckers are going V for Vendetta on the police department. Target gets ransacked. May 31st. You get the case. Did shit have to burn in order for this to finally be taken out of a local DA's hand and into your hand?
Well, what I'd say, it's in my hands primarily, but it's in both our hands.
Sure.
But what I'd say is, I don't know, Hasan, if that needed to happen that way.
But I remember 2014 with Eric Garner. Right. I remember the marching, and I remember seeing it in my feed. But there was something different in this moment where people said, not enough is enough.
Right. Well, you look, you know, this is not the first occasion of a deadly force encounter with police. I mean, Philando Castile happened not too long ago, right here in Minnesota. A lot of folks on the local community remember Jamar Clark. A lot of folks will remember other cases that happened around the country. You mentioned Eric Garner, but what about Walter Scott? What about Sandra Bland? What about so many others? And it feels like the level of accountability just isn't there. And so it had been building. In addition to that, there's this dramatic income inequality in our society where people are working really hard but feel like they're not getting anywhere. And they're frustrated that we've been under this pandemic pressure cooker. But I don't know if things have had to burn, but they did.
But and I see the line. I do. I do feel that. And I know it's tough for you as a sitting member of a very, very prestigious office. But for me, I saw it so clearly.
Right.
I said, look, people aren't listening. And there had to be a moment where, all right, we're not playing games anymore. I'm not justifying what happened, but I'm trying to say, can you not see how hurt people can be, the pain people are feeling right now?
Well, absolutely, I can see the pain of people. I can tell you this, if it hadn't been for, say, Bloody Sunday in 1965, March, would we have ever had the Voting Rights Act? Probably not, right? If we hadn't had the March on Washington in 63, would we have gotten the 1964 Civil Rights Act? Probably not. If we hadn't had, you know, the explosion of civil unrest and uprising in the mid-1960s, would we have had the Fair Housing Act? The truth is, protest and massive outpouring of outrage does create a crisis where policymakers feel that they have to act. That has been the history.
But basically what you're saying is, Target had to burn.
Well, I'm not gonna say that. But what I will say is that we are in a moment where Target did burn. And if we act like it didn't, and we just gloss it, and act like, oh, that nothing really happened there, we will be making a major failure. And we will be demonstrating tone deafness and unresponsiveness to the cries of the people.
I haven't seen a whole lot in my life, but the past 10 to 15 years of my youth, you know, being a part of, again, a social media, and you see the way these things all happen. I mean, the camera phone has been a game changer.
Oh, my God.
Right? I personally, Keith, I feel like the camera phone needs to win an NAACP award.
Right.
Like a Lifetime Achievement Award, something.
It has performed, hasn't it? It's true.
Ultimately, you're going to have to convince a jury to convict these four officers. What does the jury selection process look like?
Well, the jury selection process is more of a process of elimination than inclusion, right? So there's only gonna be 12 people on the jury plus an alternate, maybe two, people who have a settled opinion of how that case should come out, probably will not make it on the jury.
I mean, well, everybody has an opinion about this. How are you gonna get 12 to 14 Jared Letos to just walk into that room who have just come back from a 90-day digital detox and just be a complete blank slate?
Well, it's not required that jurors don't know anything and have never heard of it, but what is required is that they can understand that there's a lot of other evidence that they may not have heard and that they need to factor all of it and factor in every bit of evidence that will come in through the witness stand before they will settle on what they believe the verdict should be.
I wouldn't be eligible. I'm petty as hell. I'm super petty. I mean, like, there's times where I'll go in. We were just at the diner this morning. I didn't like the service they gave. I have a burner Yelp account, and I just gave them one star. I asked extra ice. It was no extra ice. I think it was a nominal amount of ice. So I have a burner account, Jeremy Higgins, and I went in, boom, one star. I think a lot of people in the United States are like me. They're a one-star Jeremy Higgins, petty LePew.
Well, you know, we're not looking for perfect people. We're looking for people who believe they can, in good faith, be fair.
We all want the Chauvin case to obviously end up with a conviction, but what's the likelihood? Are we talking about Meryl Streep at the Oscars, guaranteed? Are we talking about Adam Sandler at the Oscars? Like, hopefully.
I don't know.
You know how when Denzel won for Training Day, it was like the right choice, but at the wrong time? Like, he had deserved to win the Oscar for Malcolm X, but he didn't. But then he got it for Training Day, which I feel is like an movie. He's like, he's good. It's good, but it's not like Denzel's best. I just don't want this to be like one of those things.
I'll keep that in mind.
This court case is going to be a very seminal police brutality court case. This is gonna be in a Netflix documentary in 10 to 15 years. Who do you want playing you?
I don't know. What about...
Swing big. Like, pick somebody, you know what I mean?
Well, Denzel, then.
There you go.
I wish, right?
What are you? You're like a Minneapolis 7, right? So go Denzel.
Yeah, right. Why not?
It's going to be Terrence Howard.
Yeah.
Who are we kidding?
Yeah.
Yeah, probably so.
So Minneapolis is a very interesting city. It is one of the few cities that has this thing called duty to intervene, right? Basically, if a police officer sees another police officer doing something wrong, they have the duty to intervene and stop that. And if they don't, well, in this case, the three officers saw Chauvin kill George Floyd. So this is case closed, right? They should have pulled his knee off his neck.
Well, a lot of these matters are things I'm going to argue in front of the court, but here's what I can tell you. When the chief of police fired them, that was part of the reason the chief discharged them, because they violated departmental policy. Will those things be relevant in the trial? I think so, but that's pretty much all I can say.
Does duty to intervene oftentimes work in other criminal and court cases?
If chiefs don't enforce it, it does not.
Oh, so it's like duty as in, like, I have a duty to call my mom every day, but I don't. Or like, you have a duty to wipe down the elliptical after you use it, but you obviously don't.
Well, kind of, yeah. I mean, the bottom line is, there is what is written on paper as a duty. There's what people are taught and trained in the academy. There's what you're taught in in-service trainings. And then there's the culture. And they're not always the same thing.
In a lot of situations, is duty to intervene not enforced because there's that thin blue line? You don't want to seem like a rat.
Not speaking about this case in particular, I think that that is a prevailing problem. I think, you know, you've got to create an environment where good officers can be good. And in so many departments, you have environments where somebody joined the force to do the right thing. They're there to help. They want to be keep people safe. But the office culture says that you go along to get along, or you're going to be, at best, ostracized, and at worst, maybe alone in a very dangerous situation. And so I think that this is a very important moment, you know, in our nation's history. As legislatures are saying, duty to intervene, duty to assist also. And then a third one, the sanctity of life. The sanctity of life needs to be a first principle.
It's interesting that we talk about the sanctity of life, but we saw what just happened in Atlanta. Rashard Brooks was outside of a Wendy's, and everybody's talking about, well, do you know why he was out there? Do you know what a troublemaker he was? Clearly, the sanctity of Rashard Brooks' life doesn't matter. Why is that?
Well, we need to make it matter. It needs to be a front and center principle for not just police departments, but for our whole society. I mean, the bottom line is, whatever Rashard Brooks may have been going through could be fixed.
Keith, I think it's a little bit more blunt, man. I'm sorry. I really think if you're a Black person in America, you are not allowed to be flawed. That's the difference. You could take Rashard and swap him in with a water polo player named Brock.
Right.
And he could be pill popping and on a bender and asleep in front of a Dairy Queen. His life and the sanctity of his life would matter. That's what I viscerally feel, where it's just like, oh, you're immediately, if you were a Black person with any flaws whatsoever, which make us all human, by the way.
Right.
Then all of a sudden, justice, equality, those things are null and void. You're a troublemaker.
Well, I mean, look, Black parents teach their kids that very principle. You know, my father told me, look, son, if the police stop you, you keep your hands on the wheel, you don't talk back, because if they kill you, there's not going to be much I can do about it. I've had to tell my own kids that. I mean, what are we telling them other than their lives in this society simply aren't going to be valued? So if you value your own life, you've got to live by another set of rules.
What do you say to the other folks on the other side of the aisle that say, really, protesters, you want to make Rashard Brooks your hero? You want to burn down Atlanta for this guy?
Rashard Brooks is a hero because he's an ordinary guy. You can't have a society where only the most meritorious people deserve outrage when their rights are violated. I mean, look, if you're white, you don't have to be perfect to get the full protection of the law. But if you're Black, you do, and that's wrong. We need to live up to what we say we believe, which is liberty and justice for all.
But do you wipe the elliptical down after you use it?
I'm one who does. And let me tell you, if I don't, maybe the club should put me out.
Didn't we just talk about people being imperfect?
If I keep doing
it. Keith Ellison gets thrown out of 24-hour fitness? Jesus, man.
Well, what if I'm a chronic offender? I don't know.
It's interesting. Before we sat down, I walked around your office, even though it's against the rules, and I saw these photos of all the previous attorney generals from Minnesota, and it was just a dynasty. I mean, it looked like the 1950s Boston Celtics, and then there was your photo. It was just Caucasia and then bam, melanin. What does that feel like? Did you leave your seat in Congress to be able to disrupt that?
You know, Jackie Robinson, first black baseball player in the Major League Baseball. Of course, we had a whole Negro League history, but the first Major League Baseball player, he wasn't only the first, he was also Rookie of the Year. He did well, he performed well. So in this office, I feel that, yeah, I'm the first, but I also want to be the best. I want to deliver great service to the people of the state. And so it's just been an amazing year and a half. And I'm so glad I made that decision.
So your former seat in Congress is now being held by Ilhan Omar.
Yep. Good friend. I'm very proud of her.
Think about this. You become the first black Muslim member of Congress. Boom. That's you. Black Muslim convert. Then Ilhan Omar, Somali refugee. Who's going to take that seat in 20 years? Just the Quran with an afro? Like, it is getting the intensity here, Keith.
Think about all the 535 seats in Congress that have had nothing but people of European descent, and nobody's surprised about it. It doesn't cause a stir. It's considered normal.
I was shocked.
Yeah.
I'm seeing the MSA go mainstream. This is intense, bro. So the last time I checked, you are black.
Yes.
Tell me about your first run-ins with law enforcement.
You know, I do remember one occasion where my dad's Pontiac Sunbird was in bad repair. He asked me to take it to the fix-it station, the repair shop. I did. It sat there for a week and was not touched, except for the bandit who broke into it and ripped out the radio. So then I said, I'm moving this car. You guys aren't doing us any good. And I called the police and reported the theft on the car. After the officer took the report, another officer came up 5 minutes later, told me to get my effing hands out of my pockets, pointed guns at me, slammed me on the hood of the car, took me down to the station, had to call my mom to come get me out. And that left a lasting impression on me. I still know that there's tons of great cops who do good work every single day. I also know that, you know, it doesn't always go the way we would like it to.
So you got this action in the streets. We're all blacking out our Instagrams. We got the black square. We're doing our thing. We're meeting up for the protest, the whole nine. You look at the ripple effect of what's happening around the world. People are taking this seriously. Corporations are standing up. The big ones, Google, Amazon. Amazon's like, we stand with black lives. Black lives matter. Unless, of course, they're delivering Amazon. Then they can die. But people are taking notice.
Yeah.
You got Nancy Pelosi going full Kaepernick and kente cloth. Do you think that's pandering, or do you think that's actually going to lead to something? What do you actually want to see?
I think it is potentially both, but I think that it is a mistake to discount what that means, right? I mean, if we keep the protest energy going, and if we can use it to propel ourselves to truly better places, you know, I'm not prepared to say that people are just doing gestures to sort of get past the moment that we're in. Those gestures are important. Symbols can be very important. I mean, the fact that Nancy Pelosi puts on kente cloth, to me, is a recognition of black dignity. Now, the cynical can say, ah, so what, that's nothing. Well, if we stop now, maybe it's nothing. But what if we don't stop now? What if we actually use this moment to transform society?
Let's play a game.
Got it.
I'm gonna name some weapons, and you have to guess if it's a weapon that the police department owns or if it is a weapon that is used in the video game Halo.
I'll try.
Riot gear.
I think the police have that.
Yes. Tear gas.
Police.
Fist of Rukt.
I don't know. I would say Halo, because yes. I've never heard of that.
Fist of Rukt.
Okay.
Scorpion missile.
I'd have to say that's the Halo.
Correct. Tanks.
I happen to know that some police departments have them.
Wrong, it's both.
Okay.
Incineration cannon.
I'd like to think Halo.
Correct. Grenade launcher.
I'd like to say halo, but I do know that probably it's both.
Correct, both. Bayonet.
Probably both.
Yeah, how'd you know that?
Because in Congress, we had this, after Ferguson, there was this whole review of military-style weaponry that was in the hands of police departments because of surplus.
You're talking about, like, surplus, like Civil War spiky gun bayonets?
Surplus, like, military stuff that they're not using, so they sell to police departments at a very reduced price, or just plain old give it to them.
Okay. MP5 machine gun?
I'd say certainly both.
Just police?
Just, okay.
Even Master Chief is like, this is too much. I'm just trying to kill aliens. I don't need a MP5.
Right.
Energy sword.
Halo.
But MPD's working on it.
Okay.
Minnesota's a very interesting place, especially when it comes to police brutality. Philando Castile, Jamar Clark, David Smith, obviously George Floyd. In the history of Minnesota, has a white police officer ever been convicted of murder in regards to the killing of a black man?
No.
Never.
Not that I'm aware of, no.
That's insane. Do you not feel like this indicates a systemic problem?
You know, I have to keep my eyes focused on obtaining convictions in this case, which I've charged. But I can tell you that there's a lot of people in Minnesota who feel that we have a two-tiered system of justice.
What does that mean?
Well, that there's a system of justice for black and brown people, and there's another one for other people.
We talked about this on the phone. You know, you were saying, look, I don't want to abolish the police. Is
right.
that true?
That's true. I would not describe myself as an abolitionist, but I do know what the abolitionists mean. And I think that their voice is important. I think we do need to look into new systems. And I do think that both the police and the military take up an inordinate amount of their budgets for the city and the U.S. government, and that some of that budget needs to be reapportioned to be more effective in terms of solving and providing safety and security and elimination of the human rights abuses that we see associated with it so often.
It's interesting that you hold this position, which is considered to be a relatively nuanced position. The Minneapolis City Council pledged to defund and dismantle the police department and create an entirely new system. Your son voted for that, but you were against defunding the police. Now, is that a weird father-son Simba-Mufasa dynamic that's happening here?
I wouldn't say I'm against it. What I'd say is that I think that those 9 city council members what they want is greater safety, but without the human rights abuses. So, I would not say defund the police. I'd say refund the community. And put money and allocate money into things that are going to promote safety, security more effectively without the human rights problems.
But why not defund? I mean, we have tried to have police reform before in these seminal moments, 1919, 1935, 1943, 1965, all times where American citizens called for police reform, it wasn't enough. So why go Diet Pepsi in this situation? Go full calorie, defund it?
Well, we need somebody to make sure that if you get ripped off or have something stolen from you, that somebody will respond and help you deal with that. I think the way we do that needs to be carefully examined and rethought and transformed. So I would not put myself on the other side of the people calling for transformative change. What I'd say is that the way you describe what you want, I would not label myself as an abolitionist, but I would say that I understand what they're calling for. I think what they're calling for is much of it is righteous and good, and I think our society should listen.
Let me ask you this. This is a very dumb question. I told a lot of my viewers to call their member of Congress. Does that actually work?
It does work.
Come on, really?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, when I was in Congress—
That landline when it's like 1-323-587, that actually, when I pick it up, they're not just like, no. If it's Verizon or if it's any of my constituents, don't pick up.
When I was in Congress, we kept a tally on every person who called and every issue they called on. And when you start getting 2, 3, 4 calls on the same issue, we focus our attention on what's going on here. And you start getting 20, 30, 40 calls. I mean, how do you think that they stopped comprehensive immigration reform all those years? Lou Dobbs got up there and said, call Congress, kill it. And it worked. The fact is that, you know, the reason we don't have common sense gun reform is because, you know, people use their First Amendment right to get up and be against it. Those of us who want to see meaningful reforms that save lives need to be as active, if not more.
Yeah. Scene one, take three, A mark.